So today I would like to speak about an article that I found on a website named snowinberlin.com. I will give you the link in the description box below. It's about the album Laughingstock mostly. So the interview was made in September, October 1991, so it's a very long time ago. You may wonder what's the point of speaking of something so old. You know what? It's old. But still, this article, this interview is really very interesting because everything which is said in it is completely now for me. There are a lot of questions that I have in mind which are partly answered in this interview. I hope it's going to interest you. So this article was written in the magazine the Les Inrecuptibles, it's the Inrecuptible. It's a French magazine about music. I think it still exists now. Well, I've not been in France during a very long time now, but I suppose it still exists. And I think the interview is really good. Very interesting. It's written in French. So I'm going to read in French and translate in English. I can't read everything, otherwise the video is going to be too long. But if you are interested, at least you will be able to understand the most important part of it. So, he says, aujourd'hui il ne reste qu'une seule chose importante sur mes disques, c'est le silence, c'est même la chose qui compte le plus dans ma vie. On ne lui accorde plus assez de place, sans arrêt la télévision parle toute seule dans son coin, la radio est allumée sans raison, on ne devrait pas se laisser envahir de la sorte. Il faut absolument sélectionner et choisir ce qu'on entend. C'est également vrai sur les disques. Je préfère encore entendre le silence qu'une note inutile, une note plutôt que deux. Ce qui compte, c'est la façon dont elle est jouée, la technologie, la technique, tout ça ne sert qu'à remplir, donc à rien. So basically, I'm not going to do an exact translation. I'm just going to tell you what he's saying. What Marcolis is saying, basically, it's that for him, the silence is more important than anything else, and that it's better to play one note rather than two. That's something that he said very often. I think that we must absolutely choose what we want to listen and what we hear. For example, putting the TV on when you are not watching it, it's absolutely not useful. I quite agree with him. Actually, I don't have a TV in my house because I don't need to. If I want to look to watch something, I have my computer, and we can perfectly live without a TV, at least for me and obviously for him. He thinks it's also true for the records. He prefers hearing the silence rather than a note which would be totally unuseful. What counts is the way it's played. Obviously he prefers the quality rather than the quantity. It's a very interesting approach. It's very strange because right now I'm creating stuff in the bohemian spirit, and because of his music, especially in It's My Life, especially the song It's You, and also in the last album, the Marcolis album, there is something bohemian in two of his songs, and bohemian for me it's the contrary of emptiness, you know. And I make a translation between music and painting. I don't see myself doing a painting where there is nothing on it, or the emptiness. But it's true that when I do a painting, I mean an old painting on canvas, Which is something much more meaningful for me. I think a lot before doing it. For sure, I'm going to choose what I'm going to put on it, to paint on it. I'm not going to paint anything just to fill the space. No, sometimes less is more. Yes, less is more. It's exactly what he's saying. I agree with that. Sometimes I would like to do that in my house where I have too much stuff. Actually, it's very feng shui. I love feng shui. You know what? I'm going to stop the music because I need the silence to talk about that. You see? Not that I don't love his music. Of course, I love his music. But I need to focus on this subject. And I can't listen to Laughingstock and in the same time talking about it. The reason of his album is spontaneity. That is why he needs years to record them. Spontaneity is not supposed to be right away. No, but then he explains, I understand what he means. The only thing which counts for him, it's the behavior that people who come to play have. I want them to play for themselves. I don't want to tell them what to do. Sometimes some musician must play during 10 hours before I can hear 5 seconds of music that I need. He says that he lets them record a very long time and do whatever they want. And then he only keeps a small part of it, the part that he loves the most. That is basically what I do with my videos, and they are still too long. I talk and talk and talk, and then when I watch that, I think, no, that is not useful. That is not useful. I remove that. I remove that. And even when I do art, sometimes I plan to do a collage, for example, and I choose papers, and in the end, I use only a part of it. Yes. Then he says something very interesting. Well, interesting for me, at least. I don't know if it does interest you, but I think it's very interesting. When quand nous enregistrons, j'aime utiliser d'immenses studios. Ainsi, chaque instrument peut être déplacé pour que sa position lors du mixage soit juste. Ça me permet de ne jamais utiliser l'électronique. Si je veux que l'instrument soit en retrait, je fais reculer le musicien par rapport aux autres. Car la plus grande partie de nos morceaux est enregistrée live. Nous arrivons en studio avec un cadre minimum que nous jouons live. Ensuite, nous complétons avec des improvisations. Je ne sais donc jamais à l'avance à quoi ressemblent nos disques. Je passe d'ailleurs plus de temps à effacer, etc. Also, he says that when they are recording, he likes to use a huge studio size, you know, big, wide. So every instrument can be moved in the room. So the position of the instrument is right for the mix. It means, for example, if there is an instrument, you don't want to hear it too much, you want to hear it just a little. So he puts the instrument very far away from the microphone, I suppose, so we can hear it far. That is so funny. So funny, because usually, you know, it's during the mix that you decide of the level of the instruments. But it's because they play live, I mean, several instruments together. So he can't separate the instruments one from the other. One must be loud and the other one must be low. So that's why he has to move the instruments further. You know, it reminds me, my mother, when she was younger, she was singing, or even when she was older. Anyway, she was singing. And when she was recording, it was in the 60s, and I was a child. I was a very small child. But I remember musicians playing live, and sometimes they had stuff separating them. And because the tracks, yeah, the... Yes, we call that tracks. They didn't have the in the recording studio. There was no 8 tracks, 16 tracks, 24 tracks, 48 tracks, or 96 tracks, or I don't know how many. How many instruments can you put on a song? I mean, that's crazy. Sometimes they just had to record everything in the same time because it was the only possibility. And sometimes the singer was even singing in the same time. It's crazy and it's interesting, his way of doing. I really like that. I love that because it's so artisanal. It's well made. You see, even my cat agrees with me. He's always coming when I'm recording a video. You want to play drums? Yes. Yes. Oh. Oh. Okay, he wants to stay here. Okay, he's going to talk with me. So, okay, I'm sorry. So, then he says that he doesn't know in advance how the tracks will be, how the records will sound. He just know the feeling in advance, but that's it. He doesn't know where the songs are going to go. He spends more time to erase, cut, than to record. His work is basically to only épurer encore et encore. Yes, remove and remove and remove until only the necessary remains. Yeah, I do exactly like that with my videos, and still there is too much. Des heures et des heures de bande. Ah, yes, the musician don't understand that he wants to keep only the small pieces where they make mistakes or where they think they don't sound good. It's funny because in my art, I always prefer the part which is a little damaged or not exactly right, you know, because I think that it's the most interesting part of the creation. I don't like when everything is too clean, too perfect. The accidents are more art than perfection, and perfection anyway doesn't exist, so it's interesting. I love that. It's interesting. Yes, then he speaks of the punk period. He says that it was the most enthusiast period for him. Everything was very spontaneous. You didn't need to be a very good musician to play. Everybody could play. It was fun. I didn't do myself punk music, but I liked some punk music then. I was really young. I was very young. But it's true that there was an energy. It was absolutely incredible. There was a kind of freedom. We could play, sing, do whatever we wanted. Everything changed at that period. Well, I was in France, I was not in England, so it was probably less, I would say less good than in England. But I loved this period too. But I loved also the hippie period, the psychedelic period before. I was a child, so I couldn't enjoy it completely. Well, maybe it's better. Then he says that originality is everything for him. He never wanted to start a group which would be turned towards the past. He doesn't see where it can lead. He's right. I think that any artist should. Of course, as an artist, you look at what other artists do just because it's a source of inspiration. But when you are doing your stuff, whatever it is, you must do what you want to do. You must not think, oh, I want to do like this woman or like this man. Or no, you must do really what you want to express, and not wondering if it's in or out or in the right direction. You must not also try absolutely to please to the audience, because when you start doing stuff just to please the audience, it's wrong. It doesn't work like that. I sold some stuff that I did in painting or in sculpture. I would have never thought that I would sell that. And things that I was thinking, oh, maybe people will like more that, it doesn't sell. So you know, you must, when in art you really need to do what you want to do, even if it's crazy, or even if nobody likes it. Do until something happens, you know. And we can do art by thinking of the past. I don't see myself doing art and saying, oh, I'm going to try to paint exactly like Picasso. First, I would never manage to do that because he was much better than me. Second, it's not you anymore. And it needs to be you. So only you can know what you have to do, I think. Wow. Very philosophical considerations. You see, this article was written a long time ago, but it's still valid. It's very interesting. Yes, then the journalist says that at the beginning they were doing some more commercial music, pop, yes, techno-pop commercial music, says the journalist. And then Marcoli says, l'étape à laquelle nous sommes aujourd'hui parvenus n'est que la suite logique de nos débuts. Seules les contraintes ont changé. Yes, at the beginning, they didn't have a lot of time in the studio and in the recording studio, and they didn't have the same budget. So they had to go fast and do it fast. And then more the time was passing, more they had some money and some time. After The Color of Spring, they had so much success everywhere in the US and everywhere. The record company gave them unlimited budget and unlimited time to do the next album, which was Spirit of Eden. And the result is wonderful, not what the records company was hoping, of course, but still, the result is absolutely wonderful. It's a very high quality. However, you know, I am wondering if sometimes the difficulties, the fact that you have no money, or the fact that you have no time, or the fact that you don't have exactly what you want to create what you want, doesn't make you do the things really well. And it makes you work more, I think. An example, I used to work in an arts and craft supplies store in Paris. I was doing demonstration, doing workshops, I was decorating the windows, and I was trying new products. I was writing a small explanation for the products and things like that. And also training the salesmen and women working there, because they didn't know how to use the products, so I was teaching that to them. It was a part-time job, and the rest of the time I was painting on canvases, but also on objects. And more I was working in this shop, more it became more and more difficult because the economy was really bad and they wanted me to leave because they didn't have enough money to pay me. And they were about to sell the company, but I didn't know that when I was there. So they were doing everything possible to make me leave, but I didn't want to leave because I needed the money, I needed to work. And but I was painting like crazy. I was doing so many paintings. In a week I could do 2 paintings. It was crazy because I needed to express myself to escape the nightmare in my work. So it was difficult because I didn't have a lot of time. I only had some days in the week, or sometimes it was only the weekends, or even not on Saturday because I was working on Saturday most of the time. And I still had my kids at home, so it was not easy to work in these circumstances. Yes, and then when I unfortunately had to leave my job because it was becoming like crazy and they did everything they could to make me leave, it was really bad. Anyway, I thought, oh, okay, now I will have a lot of time to paint, it's wonderful, I'm going to be able to create a lot. And I started supplying stores in Paris with painted things and painted bags and painted objects. But my paintings on canvas, I mean the fine art, I didn't do as much as when I was working. So I'm wondering, sometimes in bad circumstances, don't you create more than when you have all the time that you want and all the money that you want? Of course, the more is not what is necessary, it's the quality which is important. It's true that Spirit of Eden, Laughingstock and the Marcolis album are very high quality albums. I can say it's better than the 3 first ones, because the 3 first ones are really good too. But you see, and now maybe Marcolis has nothing to say, or maybe nothing is inspiring him. Or maybe he doesn't want to do an album just for the purpose to do an album. It's not maybe, it's I know that he says that, he said that several times. But still, I'm wondering if the fact that being in a bad situation doesn't force us to do things, even if it's not exactly as we would like. I don't know. Then he says that he had to compromise at the beginning, especially before It's My Life. They didn't choose the producer that they had. And then he says our image was ridiculous. They were dressed up in white and very short hair and very clean. You know what? I don't care about that. I don't care about the look. I know that the look is important in this kind of job, but the music was really good. So they could have been dressed up like, I don't know, whatever. I loved the music way before seeing them and seeing how they were and how they were dressed up. Okay, in the clip video, they are dressed up in white. They are all in white. It's not the kind of outfits that I like, it's true. But they are not ridiculous. They are what they were supposed to be then, for a commercial company, I would say. It doesn't mean that it is who they are. we don't know who they are. We don't. Then we didn't know who they were. Now we know a little better. Well, we don't know them personally, but we understand them a little better now because a lot of time has passed. But then the most important was the music. I never found them ridiculous. Never. Never. And it's almost cute, you know. But I think we are all ridiculous at a point, you know, when I see pictures of myself in the 80s, for example, when I see what I was wearing, I think I'm ridiculous, but and maybe later I will watch myself as I am now on my videos and I will think, that is ridiculous. I think everybody is ridiculous at a point, but it's not important. The most important is the music, and we don't care if they are in white, in black, or in blue, or short hair, or long hair. They were nice, they were cute, the music was great, and that's the most important, I think. Then he says, notre image nous a également longtemps porté préjudice quand nous avons signé avec Imai. Notre image se rapprochait de celle des Doors. Nous nous sentions en accord avec cette période du psychédélisme. Mais la maison du disque nous a nettoyés. He says that they were more feeling like the Doors than what they looked then. So, you know, that I didn't know that. I just read this article last week, and I didn't know that they were seeing themselves close to the Doors. That is interesting because I was painting about Jim Morrison and now I'm painting about Marcolis and Tok Tok. That's interesting. And there is, yes, there is one song in Laughingstock that makes me think of a song of the Doors. I told that in another video. I thought it was just my idea, but no, obviously I was right, because this interview was made just after the release of Laughingstock, so I was right. There is something. There is something, at least in Laughingstock, there is something of the Doors. Finally, they could express themselves. But, you know, by in the 80s, by thinking of Tok Tok, I would have never thought of the Doors. But I didn't know Laughingstock then. He says, ma vraie image, c'est ma musique. My true image is my music. Yes, he's right. That's why he didn't want a picture of them on the cover of the records of the albums. But, you know, he has no idea of the importance of his own image, I think. It's true that the most important is the music. What he was selling was the music. He was not selling himself. He was selling his music. But I would say that in the case of Marcolis, his image is really very important because, not because he's good looking or anything, no, because he has something very human. He's, yeah, he's a human being. I mean, all the singers are human beings. I mean, for example, I was talking about Brian Ferry with someone a few days ago, of Roxy Music. A good-looking guy, tall, obviously. He doesn't look stupid, you know. He looks great, but we don't know who he is. I'm unable to tell you what kind of man he is, and he's like an image. He's like a star, like a singer. We don't know who is the man behind. We don't know who he is. He's just an image. There is no connection. I don't know how to explain that. Marcolis, he's very human, very true, sincere. So we can relate to him. He speaks not a lot, but he says important things. He doesn't play the star, you know. He's just him. That's why his image is so important. Because when we see him in interviews, when we can really see him, we see the soul, we see the spirit behind him. So it's not just only the look, it's also what he conveys when we see him talking. He doesn't know how important his image is, I think. Then he's very upset because he's speaking about the remixes which have been done by DJs. Imai didn't even ask them if they were okay with that, and that's why they had to sue the company to make the album removed. That is incredible. I don't understand how a record company can do that. It's like if someone was taking my painting and repainted it above and saying it's a new version of this painting. I would be shocked. Really, I would be so mad. It's a lack of respect, a complete lack of respect towards an artist's work, I think. These companies, they understand nothing. And I'm very happy now that some singers, some artists can show what they do just directly on YouTube, or they sell just their album directly in the concerts. They don't have a records company anymore. They are useful, the records company are useful to distribute the CDs everywhere. Of course, they are doing a job. I'm not saying they are not useful. I remember a period when there were people only specialized in the art part and other people only specialized in the commercial part. And now the commercial people give their opinion about the art part, and they know nothing about that. And they do everything it takes to make money. I understand that a company needs money. I have a company myself, so I know what it is. But it doesn't mean that you must not be correct, that you must not respect the artists, and that you can do anything you want just on the name of the money. Anyway, it doesn't work that way, you know. It sucks. It sucks. I understand he was mad, and I understand that he sued them. Good for him. He was right. Then he says, si j'avais le choix, je ne parlerais jamais à la presse. L'anonymat est une situation rêvée pour moi, celle qui me donne le plus d'espace. Yes, if he could, he would never talk to the medias. And he likes to be to be able to go outside and nobody recognizes him. It gives him more space. Oh, I quite get that. J'ai beaucoup de chance de ne plus écrire de tube. I'm very lucky not to write hits anymore. He writes hits. It's not because the records company or most of people don't recognize the hits that they are not hits. He wrote only hits. Everything he wrote were, not everything, but I would say 80% of what he wrote were hits. He knows how to write a hit. So lucky, you know, a lot of people would like to be able to do that, you know. Even in the Marcolis album, I can tell you there are several songs which are hits. It's just the way it was arranged and treated that makes them supposedly not being hits, but they are hits. I don't understand why the records company don't try to sell things of quality. You can educate people. People, if you give them only quality things, it's going to be hard. It's going to take a lot of time. But at a point, people are going to start understanding what is good, and they are going to start liking it. If you put on the radio every day, every day, every day, all the Margolis album, the solo album, well, solo, it's not solo, but the album that Margolis did himself, I can tell you that if people listen to that every day on the radio in their car, at the point they are going to know all the songs, maybe they are not going to listen to them as they should, but I can tell you that eventually they are going to like them. Because when we see the junk that we are hearing on the radio, which are supposed to be hits and which are actually big, I don't say the word shh, big shh, okay? these are not hits. These are not hits. It's just songs, tracks that a record company decided that it would be a hit, so they pay the, they give the budget to pay the promotion, so every day it's on the radio, and at a point when there is a song you didn't like at the beginning, after a while you are like, oh, actually it's not so bad, you know, but no, it's bad, it's just that it gets in your head and you think it's okay. No, no, I can tell you, I go very often to the post office and I put the radio on when I go to the post office, because I like to listen to what's new, you know. And I would say that on 100% of music played on this radio, maybe 10% is good, the rest is just to throw away. And they are supposed, and this 90% are supposed to be hits. No, it's just junk. That's it. So why a record company couldn't decide that the Margolis album is actually really good quality and they want to promote it? And then maybe people would start to listen to really good music. I'm not saying that my taste is right and the taste of someone else is wrong. But at least we can give it a chance, you know. So he says, I'm lucky not to write hits anymore. No, he writes hits. He still writes hits. I'm sure he's still writing hits and we don't know them, that's all. But anyway, he wrote only hits. And it's just that the record company didn't want to know that, to acknowledge that. And people were not given the chance to know that and to listen to that. I waited so many years before being able to listen to that. It's a shame. It's a shame. Yes. I would have loved to know all these three last albums much sooner. Then he says, il est temps que ce milieu soit un peu plus créatif, car je suis incapable de parler à des gens qui ne réfléchissent qu'en termes de produits, de format, de calibre. Peu de gens aiment la musique dans les maisons de disques. Yeah, he's saying that he's fed up to talk to people who think only of the music as a product, as a format, the way it must be, and the size, and who said that the length of a song was supposed to be this or that? That's ridiculous. He says that there are not a lot of people who really like music in the records companies. Yes, it's basically what I was saying sooner. He's right. He's completely right. It's true. They have no idea what they are talking about. They are selling music as they would sell, I don't know, peanuts. Music is art and must be treated as art. And in the records company, they don't understand that. They think only by a commercial way. I can get that, because they are supposed to make money. We must not be naive. They need money. Otherwise, the company doesn't exist anymore. But it doesn't, I think you can find a way to make money and to do quality in the same time. I don't understand why money must be automatically big. Okay, you understood what I meant. Then he says that he has been influenced by relationships he had with other musicians, rather than hiring musicians for the tours and then or for recording sessions, and then firing them. They started keeping the same musicians, and these musicians became friends with him, and he developed these relationships to know each other better and to fight the frustration, because the frustration is what pushes them forwards. It's exactly what I was saying before. My frustration in my work was making me paint more. It's exactly the same. He says we don't always know what we want, but we know what we don't want. Yeah, I know that's my problem. I always know what I don't want, but I don't always know what I want. And the fact that they were friends with the musician, he had the feeling that he could fight and act on this problem together. I like that. I like the idea of developing a relationship rather than throwing people away and choosing other people. It's better, you know, when you have a team who wins, why changing the members? Yes, and then that is much less fun. He's speaking about the tour for Color of Spring. Après The Color of Spring, nous sommes partis en tournée. Ça a été la dernière de notre carrière. Jusque-là, la routine s'était installée depuis 3 années, album puis tournée. La grande différence vient de là. Nous n'étions plus limités par le temps. Nous n'avions plus la moindre échéance dans le futur. Nous avons donc pu commencer à travailler comme nous l'entendions, à improviser. Pour moi, les tournées étaient beaucoup trop rétrospectives. Dès qu'un morceau est enregistré, je n'ai plus la moindre envie d'y revenir. En plus, j'ai décidé d'avoir des enfants et ma famille passait au-dessus des concerts. De toute façon, notre musique devenait de plus en plus difficile à reproduire sur scène. Les morceaux de notre album, de notre nouvel album, seraient d'ailleurs physiquement impossibles à jouer. Yes, so he's saying that when he was on tour, it was always too much about the songs he did before. And he was already creating something new. So it was like going backwards, you know. As soon as a track is recorded, he doesn't want to go back to it because for him it's over. However, there is an audience and people want to hear that. And we still love these musics. But he's doing them himself, so I understand that he must be a little fed up, because you know it's completely different when you just see the result of a piece of art, and you are not tired of it because you just see the fun part, the beautiful part. But when you have been working on a piece with all the difficulties and the flaws and the thing that you must correct, and like me, when I'm doing a painting, at the end I'm exhausted because I've been fighting with it and working on it, and some things are maybe not exactly what I wanted, and there are some difficulties. All that to say that when you create a piece of art, it's much more difficult to watch it or to listen to it again and again. And on the contrary, for the audience, or for the listener or the viewers, it's much easier to watch or listen to it again and again because you didn't do it yourself. And he says that he had kids and he wanted to, they were more important than the tour. That's amazing. I mean, an artist who stops touring to take care of his kids, wow, that is so rare, so rare. My mother never stopped her tours for me, but I had a wonderful nanny, so I'm glad she continued her tours. She wanted to do that. I wouldn't like my parents to sacrifice themselves just for me. But I don't think that Marcoli sacrificed himself. He was fed up with the tours, and the music he was doing was also, that's what he says, was also difficult to play on stage. So that was another problem. Anyway, it's still amazing that he thinks of his kids. That is really rare. The stars, rock stars, thinking of their children. Wow. What is much less fun is that he says that he had to be. Oui, il fallait que je sois ivre en permanence, c'était très inquiétant. Nous jouions 6 jours par semaine et je devais donc être totalement bourré 6 soirs par semaine. Ce n'était même pas un plaisir, mais une nécessité. Sans alcool, j'étais incapable de monter sur scène. Quand nous avons commencé, c'est l'enthousiasme qui me faisait grimper sur scène, mais ça, je l'ai vite perdu. La routine, la répétition l'avaient vite tué. Yes, he says that he had to be drunk all the time to go on stage. And they were playing 6 days in a week, 6 days on seven. So he had to be drunk 6 evenings per week. You know, first I would say, how a company can make them play 6 days a week? That is insane. I'm not even sure that it's legally right. I don't know how it is in England, but my mother would have never been able to do that. That is insane. And their tour were lasting, according to what I read somewhere else, they were lasting 9 months or 1 year, something like that. That is crazy. Nobody can handle that. That is really sad because it's not supposed to be like that. And he says, quand nous avons commencé, c'était l'enthousiasme qui me faisait grimper sur scène. Yes, when they started, he was so enthusiastic to go on stage. And it shows when you watch the tours in 1984, we can see how happy he is to go on stage. It's a pleasure to see that. But if you go on the live in Montreux, the concert is wonderful. It's really well played. He sings wonderfully. The video is great. But, I have a but, he seems so bored. He seems so tired. He has to sit between the songs or at the end of the songs when the musicians are playing. That is so sad to see, to watch. I have the live at Montreux. I watched it. I watched it once. I can't watch it twice because it breaks my heart to see that. There is something completely off in during this tour, and now I know what he had to drink to be able to do it. He says that he refused to listen to the radio and to watch the TV. He hears there are too many things that he doesn't want to hear. I don't know if he's speaking of the music or of the news. I think he's speaking about the both. He doesn't like to hear the news, and he shouldn't listen to the news now because it's getting worse and worse. So on Laughing Stock, he says that there is a lot of improvisation. Musicians come and they play what they want, but there are a few things that he thought before. The first track of the album, we have the feeling that the drummer is setting his drums while the other ones have started to play. That's fun. And that he would be ready only for the second track. You know, I love these kind of things. For example, when I shoot videos, you know, during my artwork and my the musicians are outside of my shop, and I have a violinist and a DJ coming most of the time. And you know, sometimes I'm filming and they are not playing, they are just talking or saying stupid things, you know, but or they are just settling their stuff and I'm filming. And I love these moments because it makes me think of the Teen Pop videos too. You know, these times which where Markolis is not especially singing but just saying something. I like that. That's what makes the person more human and more true, because we see a little of behind of the scene. So it makes the whole video more warm, yes, warm and real, yes, something like that. And on the third track, he says that only one note is played, you know, during several minutes. I remember that. And I like it. He says that he has been dreaming of that since several years. You know, I love things which look like nothing else. That's what we call originality, I suppose. That's probably why I love Markolis music. De toute façon, mes paroles sont écrites à propos d'un personnage qui n'est pas ma... Yes, he says, anyway, my lyrics are written about a person who is not myself. C'est lui qui ressent les sentiments, qui les exprime. He's the one who feels the feelings and who express them. And weirdly, when I sing this text, when I close my eyes, I feel exactly the same thing as he does. He thinks it's not himself. I'm not saying he's lying. He thinks it's not himself, but if he speaks about that, it's probably because it's something which is in his mind. Maybe he doesn't realize that it's in his mind, but you know, maybe also he said that because he doesn't want to give explanation about what he's talking about. That's understandable, I think. Okay, so I talked a lot. My next video will be more arts and craft. I'm doing some stuff for Valentine's Day and I've been inspired by the song It's You, written by Markolis and made by Tok Tok. So it will be really arts and craft, and I do other stuff, and once I will be further on my painting, I will come back to it. So thank you for watching. If you arrived so far, thank you. You are very brave. I'm very interested in these things. That is the kind of conversation I would like to have with him, but it's not possible, so I'm talking alone or with you. It depends how you see the thing. Right now I'm alone, but I'm sharing with you. And if you have something to say about it, please do in the comments. Everything is welcome as long as it's not insulting. Have a great day.